Welcome back to The Point. We are in our continuing coverage, remembering Betty Ford. The First Lady passed away Friday evening. We have a full schedule of events of what's going to happen, how you can pay your respects. You just heard from Leon Hendricks a couple of moments ago, and you can go right now and sign that condolence book. It's open at the museum 24 hours a day between now and the time that the First Lady's remains come back here to Grand Rapids. That will happen on Wednesday. Services will be on Thursday. Those will be an invitation event. They are not open to the public. However, we will broadcast them live. But to find out all of the things that are going to happen over this week and those ceremonies for former First Lady Betty Ford, go to woodtv.com. We have all of that on there. We welcome back former Secretary of State Terry Lynn Land, who in many ways kind of got your political start working on the 76 Ford campaign. I want to talk a little bit specifically about the First Lady, because not only as somebody who has held public office and you've been out there, but as a female who has benefited from the openness created by Betty Ford. In 1974, a short time after the president unexpectedly took the oath of office, she was diagnosed with breast cancer. And at the time, we both remember very well, you didn't talk about that. People didn't openly reference that. And she, in fact, waited 48 hours to tell her husband. When she did, she then made the decision that hadn't been made in over 50 years for a First Lady to have her medical condition discussed in the media. Not only that, she invited photographers into her hospital room while she was recovering. That has changed the way people view particularly breast cancer and women's health in general. How big of a contribution do you think that has been?
Well, I think it was huge. I mean, there's no doubt about it. I mean, women's health has always been, because it was different. In fact, the first studies that medical research used to do, they used to do it on men, just assuming that whatever research they did on men, whether it was the heart or any other kind of research, that would affect the women the same way. And we found out over time that it is not. And so I think her doing that and putting that out in the open and letting women know that it's important to get mammograms and it's important to, you know, consult your doctor and to make sure that you're keeping up on all of that, really opened that up. And I think a lot of that has really changed how we do women's health. There's been a lot of research now more on women rather than just men, and finding out they are different in their physiology and how their body works. So I think she definitely had a huge impact on all of that.
What is it like, do you imagine? I mean, because you as Secretary of State had an opportunity to impact people, because you had a big pulpit and one of the biggest agency in the state, dealing with everybody in the state. How much pressure does somebody like a First Lady feel, because they have this wide reach, even if they don't realize it, that everything they do has some impact? In the case of Betty Ford, who knows how many lives have been positively impacted by that medical research that she helped spawn. One expert told us yesterday it wasn't just about the awareness, it wasn't just about early detection, but because she made this something people would talk about, the medical community responded by increasing the abilities to today. The ability to detect cancer is quantum leaps ahead of what it was in 1974. How big a responsibility is that as a public figure?
Well, it's something that it's hard to measure. In one of the quotes that I like about Betty Ford that I saw, she says, "I was born to be outspoken." And I think she was, and definitely for her time to be outspoken on so many different issues, whether it's political or the health issues, really did make a difference. And I know that as President Ford sometimes might have cringed a little bit, but he never, in fact, I think he seemed to enjoy it, the fact that she had a different opinion and that she spoke about it. And you know, you really do. And as Secretary of State, I only was in Michigan, but you have to realize everything you say, the media may pick up, and you've got to be careful how you say it so they don't interpret it wrong. And as she just said, from what was from her heart and what she felt.
That's interesting, because she never really, I mean, it wasn't that, she obviously knew what she believed and she was very articulate, but it didn't appear that she couched her words.
No.
She was pretty much just out there, and particularly for the time, that had to be pretty interesting, because you know that as President of the United States, you're an entity, but you have all of these satellites around you who are trying to control a message. That must have driven them crazy.
Well, that is true. There's always the spouse. In any campaign that I've ever worked on, wherever it is, you know, you're dealing with the spouse and what they may say. And even though they may say it casually to a friend or whatever, it can get out there. And at the height of being the president and the leader of the free world, needless to say, that is a huge platform. And for her, when she spoke, which I believe she truly spoke from her heart, that it did make a difference. And I'm sure there was a lot of conversation. congratulations on that.
Another interesting thing about this first lady is you leave the White House, and it was the only election that they'd ever lost. They had been successful 13 times here in West Michigan, and it was a close election. There are those who look back and say that election, had it gone another 48 hours, might have had a different impact, but no matter. They go to California. They are now private citizens. They have no responsibility to anybody to really deal with the media. Yet, 2 years later, they come forward, particularly the First Lady, and says, look, I have been fighting an addiction to prescription medicine and with alcohol over the course of all of these years. I have chosen to seek treatment. And beyond that, I am going to make it possible for others to do the same. How courageous was that?
Well, very. I mean, to admit you have a problem, obviously, is the first thing. And the fact that their family did an intervention and spoke to them. And I was reading recently, too, where she felt, you know, here I'd tried to be the best mother and the best wife and all of this, and not realizing how this was affecting other people. And I think that really hit her hard when she realized that. And so then she, you know, went and dealt with that issue. And then the best part of it was is she went out and then helped others. I mean, there's been lots of stories of people, you know, who have been able to deal with their addiction problems because of Betty Ford.
We've heard that from people who have been signing the condolence book. In fact, there was a great story yesterday of somebody talking about how her experiences and bringing the problems of addictive behavior to light really helped them, not because they themselves were addicted, but they came from a family in which that was an issue. And again, it is a little difficult. If you're watching, if you're, for example, you're 30 years old and you're watching the show this morning, you don't remember how taboo it was because people didn't deal with it. If you had someone in your family that was dealing with an alcohol problem or a prescription drug problem, that wasn't what you talked about. In fact, you did everything you could to keep that quiet, and she changed that.
Right, definitely. And, you know, drinking was so much more social then. I mean, everybody, you know, I can remember, too, when I first got involved in the campaign, at lunch people would have a drink. Now, I come from Western Michigan, a little conservative, and, you know, so that was a little new to me, but it was so socially acceptable to drink that if you had a problem, it almost like people didn't notice it, or, oh, she just had one too many tonight, or whatever, and it wasn't until, you know, later that people started to realize how that was an addiction, and that wasn't something that they could control, and they were losing who they were, and they weren't able to be, you know, their true person. And so I do think that, you know, her being able to take that and handle that and help others really was a benefit to our nation.
You went on from that campaign to be elected to the King County Clerk's Office, statewide elected twice as Secretary of State. What did Betty Ford, who never was elected to any office, what did Betty Ford do to open the avenues for females particularly to be involved in politics? Because even though she never held office, she did have an influence on the way that women in the public arena were viewed.
Well, she always encouraged it and talked about it, which I thought was important too. She was another woman that talked about it and talked about the need of women being in office. And she, you know, any woman that would win, she'd congratulate them. She took a special interest in all of that. And I think that was important. Women tend not to run for something unless they're asked. That's a challenge that we have, and also they have to be encouraged, a little different than men. And she wanted to make sure that you know, she could tell folks out there that women have a different perspective that's needed in government. They look at things a little differently. They, you know, they have a different life experience, and they need to bring that to government. And she was always out there recruiting and encouraging women to run, and I think that was very important.
And as she might have said, a woman's place is in the House and Senate, right?
That's exactly right, yeah.
We've got more, and we'll be back with more To the Point in just a moment.